Now this evening, for the reading of God's Word, what I want to do is just simply read one verse. And then as we get into the message, I'm going to read the rest of the psalm. But I want to read it from a particular perspective, I think, that will at least make it a bit more profitable for us, sort of cutting to the chase and dealing with it from the perspective as how it applies to us rather than how it applied to Israel in particular. But let me begin by looking at the principle that we're going to focus on once we've read through the psalm, through the introductory remarks in verse 18 of Psalm 33, where the psalmist writes this: "Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear Him, on those who hope for His loving kindness." Now again, it's going to be reiterated in the last verse of this psalm, and what I want us to consider this evening, of course, is the hope, the fact that we can have hope in the Lord. We can hope because of His loving kindness, and we're not going to have time to deal with it, but I do want you to see the connection that exists between that and fear, the fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, the beginning of knowledge. It's something that Solomon capitalizes on in the book of Proverbs, but one of the things that comes out of this kind of fear, which is not a terror of God's judgment, but rather in the Lord Jesus Christ, a fear of displeasing Him, is that rather than being terrified by God's justice and judgment, instead we are made to hope for His loving kindness and His mercies. Well, as I've already been mentioning this morning, we were looking at another very important element in our seeking God's kingdom and putting God's kingdom first, and that certainly is faith. Faith is the conviction that God is faithful, and realizing He is faithful, banking our lives on the fact that He will do what He says He will do. It's trusting Him and acting upon that trust, looking to Him to take care of us, looking to Him to give us the grace to move forward in His work. The author to the Hebrews tells us that without faith we cannot please God, because we must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who seek Him. If we don't believe that, then obviously we are not going to receive anything from the Lord, because He rewards those who know He exists and who seek Him. Now, we also noted this morning that we already have faith if we have trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, God made us a promise, salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. If we received it, the only way we could is by faith, but that's exactly what we need in order to receive all the promises of God. Faith doesn't need to be strong by God's mercy and grace in order to receive what Jesus offers, His righteousness and His forgiveness. But it does need to be genuine. Even the weakest faith is enough to receive what God offers to us through the Lord Jesus Christ. But we also saw that if we are to seek the kingdom of heaven in the way that He calls us to, the stronger our faith is, the better it will be. Such a faith, a strong faith, helps us in many different ways. It helps us to see the kingdom of heaven more clearly. It makes us strive to enter it more ardently. It helps us to know that when we ask God for help, that He will give it to us. And to know that He will give it to us even if after we ask it seems like everything else goes against us. And that even these things that are going against us, the trials, the difficulties we have to face, the Lord will even work those things together for our good. And again, I would just ask you to think back on how the Lord has used various things in your own lives, the various trials, the various temptations you've gone through, and how the Lord has advanced the image of His Son in your life in a way that you really didn't even expect. I mean, we pray and we ask God to do these things, and we kind of hope that He'll sort of zap us from heaven, give to us this great faith and this great strength and this great Christ-likeness, and we can just kind of go out and do then what the Lord calls us to do. But again, we know that isn't the way that the Lord typically works. Sometimes he does, but oftentimes what he does is he throws us into the crucible, turns up the fire, and he begins to purify our faith. He begins to, again, just sort of smelt us down, let the impurities rise to the surface so that we will be, again, conformed to the image of Jesus Christ. Look at all the examples in Scripture. Not one of Jesus' followers had an easy life. Now, this evening, I want us to approach basically the same subject from another angle by looking at what it is the Lord wants us to do while we are waiting for him to do what we know that he will do because he has promised. What we are to do is to hope in his loving kindness. Now, here's where I want us to consider the psalm that was written to encourage us to do this very thing. Now, we know it was originally written to God's people, Israel, to remind them that their ultimate well-being, their security, came from him. Didn't come from anything they did. Didn't come from their might or their power to deliver them from their enemies and to provide for them and keep them safe. Everything they needed came from the Lord. But I thought rather than looking at it, and we're only going to survey this psalm very briefly because we want to focus on these things, as it were, as many reasons why we should hope in the Lord's loving kindness. Rather than looking at it from their perspective, let's look at it as it applies to us through the gospel. Since every promise that the Lord has made to his people that he has given to us are made sure through the Lord Jesus Christ, not only the promises he made in the Old Covenant, but the promises he makes to us in the New Covenant, and they are essentially the same, only we have the greater reality behind many of the shadows that the typological promises. So how do we look at this psalm, Psalm 33, from a gospel perspective? Well, let's do it this way. First of all, let's see the psalmist calls us to worship the Lord, to sing to the Lord, to express the joy of our hearts with our whole hearts and with the greatest musical skill that we have to offer him. In other words, let's give the Lord our best, our whole heart, all of our joy, all of our love and worship. He says in verses 1 through 3, "Sing for joy in the Lord, O you righteous ones. Praise is becoming to the upright. Give thanks to the Lord with the lyre. Sing praises to him with a harp of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully with a shout of joy." There's many things we could actually look at in this particular passage, but I don't want to spend much time on it because I do want to get to the point. But how does one become righteous except by trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ? What kind of a song are we to sing to him? Songs of deliverance, songs of joy, songs of thankfulness. Notice, with instrumentation and a new song. In other words, let's not just sing the same old songs over and over again. Let's get some new songs in here. And I think what he has in mind is, as the Lord shows us new acts of deliverance and mercy, let's write a song about it. Bring it into the worship of God, and let's praise him. Now, why should we praise him? The psalm also addresses that. Because of who the Lord is. He is faithful. He is righteous. He is just. He has done what he has promised. He has revealed his mercy and his love to us in the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at what he says in verses 4 and 5. Why should we sing this song to the Lord? "For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the loving kindness of the Lord." By the way, this word, loving kindness, is a special word we're going to come back to in just a little bit. It refers to God's covenant love and mercy that ultimately comes through the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the earth today is full of the display of that loving kindness because the gospel is being preached in various places. But I think in these days it was confined to the land of Israel, because this is talking about God's special mercy that he has for those who trust in him. We should worship him because of the infinite power that the Lord has displayed, that he has exercised on our behalf in bringing us out of the kingdom of darkness and bringing us into the kingdom of light. Verses 6 through 9, by the word of the Lord the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth all their hosts. He gathers the waters of the sea together as a heap. He lays up the deeps in storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him, for he spoke and it was done. He commanded and it stood fast. Why does the psalmist reflect upon God's infinite power in the creation, except that we would put our trust in him, that we would hope in him, that we would realize that he is the only one who actually could have delivered us from the kingdom of the evil one? We should sing to him because by his sovereign power, he has overruled the plans of the enemy, and in this deliverance has brought us into the kingdom of his Son as he has planned. God will do all his holy will. And again, remember, our salvation is dependent ultimately upon God's sovereign good pleasure. Verses 10 and 11. The Lord nullifies the counsel of the nations. He frustrates the plans of the peoples. The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart from generation to generation. There were many nations that were Israel's enemies, but God frustrates their plans. We had enemies, and they had a design on us, and that design was to destroy us. But the Lord had another plan, and his plan is the one that stands. We should worship the Lord because in his infinite mercy he has chosen us to give us to Jesus, and through him the blessings that Jesus has earned for us, not the least of which is that we might be adopted as the children of God. In verse 12, the psalmist writes, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people whom he has chosen for his own inheritance. Remember that we are what Jesus inherits. We are what he gets for the work that he has done. We are his reward, his bride, the one whom he loves, his great treasure. We are the people whom he has chosen for his own inheritance. And we should worship him because by his grace, he has enabled us to trust in Jesus for our well-being, not only for our deliverance from the kingdom of darkness, but also for our continual preservation until he finally brings us home. And I think we see that in verses 13 through 21. The Lord looks from heaven. He sees all the sons of men. From his dwelling place, he looks out on all the inhabitants of the earth. He who fashions the hearts of them all, he who understands all their works. The king is not saved by a mighty army. A warrior is not delivered by great strength. A horse is a false hope for victory, nor does it deliver anyone by its great strength. Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope for his loving kindness, to deliver their soul from death and to keep them alive in famine. Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield, for our heart rejoices in him because we trust in his holy name. I want you to notice that the psalmist basically pointed out everything that man tends to trust in, whether it's the strength of a warrior or whether it's the power of a horse. He says that is not what delivers them. If there is deliverance, it comes from the Lord. Ultimately, he is the one, and he knows. He looks out on all the children of men, and he knows who it is who loves him, and he knows who it is that hopes in him, and those are the ones that he protects. Those are the ones he delivers. Those are the ones that he shows his loving kindness because they trust in him. Now, I want you to see that when we're talking about the loving kindness of the Lord, here is a great explanation of the love and the mercy that God shows to us in the Lord Jesus Christ. If we understand this as how the Lord has exercised these things on our behalf through the Lord Jesus Christ. Now the psalmist closes then with a request. that the Lord would bless us with His loving kindness, with His covenant mercies, with His love, to the degree that we have placed our hope in Him. Verse 22, let your loving kindness, O Lord, be upon us according as we have hoped in you. Now again, this is an overview, and I just simply wanted to bring this out because when we're talking about the loving kindness of the Lord, this is a great explanation of what that loving kindness is. But it extends beyond just the things we see here, and it applies to everything that the Lord has to give us through the Lord Jesus Christ, every promise, every blessing He has promised to us. We do need to hope in Him for these things, and that's what I'd like us to zero in on in verses 18 and verse 22. Verse 18 says, behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear Him, on those who hope for His loving kindness. And then verse 22, let your loving kindness, O Lord, be upon us according as we have hoped in you. I want us to zero in on these things to consider what we are to do. From the time we look to the Lord in prayer and ask Him to give us some promised mercy to the time that we actually receive that mercy, what are we to do? Hope in the Lord's loving kindness. Now, hope, first of all, I think we need to understand, is the expectation that we will receive a mercy that the Lord has promised, but we have not yet received. And again, I would point to our meditation. Our meditation where Paul says in Romans 8:24, for in hope we have been saved. But hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what he already sees? It doesn't take faith to believe that you're going to receive what it is you already have. But faith is required to believe that the Lord is going to give you something that you don't yet have, or that humanly speaking appears to be an impossibility. Now let's think about a few examples. When God told Noah that He was going to destroy the world with a flood, but that He was going to save Noah through the building of an ark, this obviously required faith on the part of Noah to build the ark, particularly when you consider it was a project that took 100 years to complete. But it also required hope, not the hope necessarily that God was going to send the flood, that was perhaps a fear, but the hope that God was actually going to deliver Noah and his family through the ark. That was the hope that Noah had during that time. Now, again, he hadn't seen the flood. He hadn't seen God's deliverance, but God had made him a promise, and he had the hope that if he built the ark, that is what God was going to use to deliver him. By the way, I can't help but, again, just point out that this ark is really a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's those who were safe in the ark, that were kept safe through the flood. And if we trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, the same will be true of us. We will be kept safe in the ark. That's our hope. When God called Abraham to leave the land of his birth, telling him that, you know, I'm going to give you another land, not only for you, but also for your children, Abraham left on the bare word of God, not knowing where he was going. He had never been there before. He had never seen that land, but he had the hope that God would fulfill his promise. And of course, the Lord did. But between the time the promise was given and the time that he actually received it, he had hope. By the way, we should mention too that Abraham never actually possessed that land, but even when he died, he still had the hope that it would be given to his children. This land was a picture of heaven that the Lord has given to each of us who have put our trust in the Lord Jesus. We have not yet received heaven. We have not yet received the new heavens and the new earth, but we do have the hope that they will be ours. When God promised to Abraham a son, Abraham was 90 years old, past the time of having children, as you know. But Abraham believed God. Sarah did too, although with a little bit of weakness. And Abraham had hope that he would fulfill that promise, even though he had to wait another 10 years before the Lord actually did. Now, through these examples, I want us to see this, that hope isn't something that says, I'm not sure whether I'm going to receive what God promised or not, but I certainly hope I will. Okay, that's not what hope means in this context. Hope means this: I know that God is faithful to his promise, and so I have a certain expectation that I will receive it when it is the Lord's time. Remember the passage of Scripture that says if we ask him anything according to his will, he hears us. And if he hears us, we know that we have already received what it is we have asked. Now, we may not have it right away, but we do have it in principle. We do know the Lord is going to give it to us. We have that hope and that expectation. Now, we have the hope, as I mentioned before, that if we have trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, that on the day of judgment, he will acquit us of all of our crimes, and he will receive us. We will be kept safe in the ark of God's salvation in the Lord Jesus Christ. We have that hope, even though that day has not yet happened. Why do we have hope? Because the Lord has promised it. We have the hope that after that judgment is complete, that we're going to enter into the new heavens and the new earth, that we're going to spend eternity with the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We'll see God. And we've talked about in the past what a great blessing that will be. We can't hardly imagine. But you know how it is when you see something you consider to be beautiful and how much joy and pleasure it gives you by just looking at it. God is the most beautiful conceivable being. We can't even imagine how glorious he is. But we'll get to see him. We'll get to see Jesus sitting at his right hand. And we'll, of course, have that experience of the Holy Spirit. We'll be in the company of the saints and of the angels. We have the hope that we're going to be there, basically what the land of promise pictured. Even though we haven't seen that place, the new heavens and the new earth, even though that place doesn't exist, it is still our hope that we will be there someday. Again, not I hope I'm going to be there, but the certain expectation that God is going to do what he said, he's going to create it, and he is also going to bring us into it. Not by our strength, not by our might, not by our power, not by our righteousness and our holiness, but because of his mercy and grace in the Lord Jesus Christ. We have this hope because we have faith, because we know God will do exactly what he said he would do because he is faithful. And the same thing is true, same thing applies to all the other blessings that God has promised. If God said it, then we should believe it. And if we believe it, we can know by faith that it is ours and will be ours. If it's something that is yet future, we have that hope. Even though we have to wait, we have this hope. Now, why do we have this hope? Remember this morning we talked about, you know, why we believe we can trust the Lord. Well, one of the reasons is because he's infinitely holy and righteous, and God can't lie. He's not going to tell us lies. What he said is true. But also because God has the power to fulfill everything that he says he's going to do. God not only will do it, he can do it. But I want us to look at one other thing in here, which we all understand, but which the psalmist draws our attention to. Why do we have this hope that God will fulfill his promises to us? And the reason is because of the Lord's loving kindness. Now, this word loving kindness is a word in the Hebrew that refers to something special. I told you this before. To God's special love and his mercy that comes from the grace of God. It comes from, at least as we understand it, this covenant that God made among himself. Remember, there's three persons of the Trinity. We call it the covenant of redemption, the covenant of grace. And it's this agreement the Father would send his Son into the world in order to purchase salvation for us, in order to purchase the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit would come and he would apply that salvation to all whom Jesus gave his life for. Okay, this is what we call the covenant of redemption. But it is the source from which everything God has for us flows. Now, this word loving kindness can refer to that source, that is the motive, why it is God gives us what he gives, but it can also refer to those individual blessings that he gives us out of this covenanted love and mercy. Now, we do need to understand that this love emanates from the Lord Jesus. If Jesus had not done what he did, there would be no love for any of us. There would be no mercy. There would be no grace. It all comes through what our Lord Jesus Christ has done. I mean, consider, God did not love us because we were lovable. The Bible says that God loved us even before we existed, when we were just a thought in his mind. He loved us before we were born, even from all eternity. Paul writes in Romans 8:29, "For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to become conformed to the image of his Son, so that he, Jesus, would be the firstborn among many brethren," that is, the saints. Now, foreknowledge here, again, I would remind you, does not refer to God's knowing ahead of time what's going to take place, because he knows everyone ahead of time. He knows what we're going to do, and as God looks down the corridors of time, what does he see? Apart from his grace and mercy, he sees the whole human race hating him and running away from him. That's what the Bible says is our condition as we come into the world. It's not foreknowing what we would do, but it's foreknowing us. And this word foreknowledge is referring not to what he knows about us, but rather to an intimacy that he purposed to have towards us. Remember that passage in Genesis 4, verse 1, "And Adam knew his wife Eve, and she conceived and bore a son." He didn't just know about her, but he was intimate with her. He loved her. And that's the sense in which the word know is being used here. God loves us in advance, and he predestines us to become conformed to the image of his Son. Now, why did he love us in advance when we clearly did not love him? When there was nothing at all good in us? Well, it's because of his purposes toward us, to put us in the Lord Jesus Christ, where then he would know that we would be lovable because of the righteousness of his Son. The same reason why he loves us now. It's not because we're so great, but it's because of his Son, because of his Son's perfections and his righteousness. It is true that God says, or Jesus says in his word, "God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son." But the love that he had for the world was a different kind of love. He could not love us in the sense that we were beautiful, because the world was not beautiful. The world was in rebellion against God, but it was because of his love and his mercy that he sent his Son so that he might actually make those who trust in his Son actually lovely in the Lord Jesus. He loves us for the sake of his Son. Why does he show us all these promises, or give us all these promises? To provide for us, to protect us, to watch over us. It's because of his Son, Jesus, because Jesus actually earned those blessings so that he might freely give them to us. Loving kindness is this covenanted mercy, the mercy that God shows because of the covenant that he made with us in his Son, the covenant he made with his Son, and the covenant he made with us through his Son. Paul writes to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, "For as many as are the promises of God, in him, in Christ, they are yes. Therefore also through him is our amen to the glory of God through us." These promises are only good because Jesus did the work that he has done. All of this mercy, all of this love, all of this, again, covenant love and mercy comes through what our Lord Jesus Christ has done. So we have hope that we will receive everything that God has promised because of this loving kindness, because of his loving kindness through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have the promise of salvation. Presently, we experience certain things, but we have the hope of the full package. we have the hope of His provision, of His protection, of the fulfillment of all of His promises, which are made yes and amen to us in the Lord Jesus Christ. We have the promise or the hope of deliverance on the day of judgment. We have the hope that we will be with the Lord in the new heavens and the new earth, which will be our permanent home, and we will get to enjoy that with Him forever. But I do want you to notice once more that when it comes to the particular mercies that have to do with this life, not with those that have to do with salvation, at least as we think of it in its particulars, you know, of the imputed righteousness of Jesus, the forgiveness of sins, the fact that we're going to be in heaven, those things are guaranteed to us even if we have the weakest faith and the weakest hope. Although I do have to say, our ability to know that they belong to us will vary according to the strength of our faith and so forth. But when it comes to these particular mercies that have to do with this life, the psalmist says that these things will be ours according to the strength of our faith or the strength of our hope. Notice again what he says in verse 22. Let your loving kindness, O Lord, be upon us according as we have hoped in you. Jesus reminded us this morning that if we waver in our faith, where there was very little faith, he was able to do very little. James reminded us that if we doubt the Lord's promises, we can't expect to receive anything. A strong faith, as it were, calls down the blessings of God. Where there is strong faith, where we believe that God is able to do this, then God does more. I pointed to George Mueller as an example, just again to remind you, somebody who is strong in the faith. Elijah is another example. He was a man who had the same nature we do, but he prayed fervently that it wouldn't rain, and it didn't rain for 3 years. And he prayed again, and God opened the windows of heaven. If we ask in faith, we will receive from the Lord, and in like manner, a strong faith produces a strong hope that those things are ours and will be ours, but a weak faith produces a weak hope. Now, since we need all the things that the Lord promises to us in order to do what the Lord calls us to do, we all need to be encouraged again to nurture our faith. A strong faith brings a strong hope through the Word, through prayer, and by remembering all the times the Lord has in His mercy answered our prayers and provided for us in His grace, the track record of the Lord, that should encourage us to trust Him today. With the strength that a stronger faith brings, we can have a stronger and more reassuring hope that the Lord will give us the mercies that He has promised and purchased for us through His Son, the Lord Jesus, in this life, as well as to know with greater certainty that we will receive the mercies that He has promised for us in the future. Do you want to have a life that is free from worry? Remember that it doesn't matter how much wealth we have, it doesn't matter how much personal ability we have, it doesn't matter how much strength we have, how many gifts. The Lord is our hope. And He should always be our hope. We need to trust in Him, in His promises, not in ourselves, not in others, but rather in Him. Hope in the Lord. Hope, again, according, He will give to us according as we have hoped in His covenant mercy and grace in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let the Lord be that hope for you. Well, let's bow in prayer and let's ask the Lord to help us to do that very thing, to place our hope in Him.